What's up, everyone? Sam here from ByteByteByte.com, and in this video, I'm going to show you how to solve the longest substring without repeating characters problem, which is a super common interview problem that you're likely to see in your interview. And if you haven't already, make sure that you go ahead and hit that subscribe button and the bell icon so that you get notified every week when we release new videos. All right, so in this problem, we are finding the length of the longest common substring in a string, right? So we have this example here where we have ABC, ABC, BB. And so there are a couple different options here that would be valid, right? We could look at, you know, ABC would be a valid substring. If we continued on and we included this A, all of a sudden now we have two repeated A's, right? And so that wouldn't be valid. But there are other options that we could have as well. We could have BCA. We could have CAB, we could have this ABC here, we could have, and that's it, right? Because any of the other ones, like, you know, if we had BCB, that would be shorter. If we had C, and that would also, or that would include a duplicate. If we had CB or BC, those would be shorter. And so none of those would be sort of the optimal solution. And so let's think about how we're gonna approach this problem here. And we're going to go over this a lot more in the next module, but the way that I want you to think about this is in terms of five steps. And so the first step that we're going to look at is what are sort of the assumptions, what is the overarching knowledge that we need to know about the question, what is our function definition, all of this sort of stuff. And so just making sure that we really understand the problem. So in this case, you know, our function definition, we're taking in a string and we're going to return an integer, right? We're not actually, and this is an important point, we're not returning the string itself. So we wouldn't be returning like A, B, C. We're actually just returning 3, right? And so, which is convenient for us here because it means that it doesn't matter which of these strings we actually choose. We just need to find the length. And so this is where we're going to start with. And then let's write our function definition. So we're going to have, you know, our function, we could call it, you know, just substring. And it's going to take in a string. And it's going to return an int. And I'm doing some crazy pseudocode here. So just like, you know, whatever language you're using, just do whatever's appropriate for that. You can actually define the function definition itself as it would be in that language. But so now we have this, and the question is like, let's make sure that we're clear on all the parameters around the problem. In this case, you know, we might be wondering like, what is sort of the valid set of characters we could have here? Are there capitals and lowercase? Are those distinct? All this sort of stuff. And so let's just make a basic assumption that, you know, we're only going to look at lowercase alphabetical characters, right? So we're only looking at lowercase a through lowercase z. And what that means is that we have 26 characters in total, and that actually tells us a lot of information already because it tells us that our longest possible string is going to be 26 characters. Right, and so now we have a basic understanding of the problem. Let's talk about the next step here that we want to look at is what is a brute force solution to this problem. So let's throw out any idea of, you know, efficiency or anything like that, just like what is the most brute force solution we could take? And with anything like this where we're looking at like what is the longest substring there, or what is the most or least whatever, one of the that language kind of clues me at least into the fact that we have a sort of finite set of possibilities, right? We have a finite set of possible strings, of possible substrings that we could generate from this string. And so what we could do for our brute force solution is really simple. We could just find all of the substrings of our input and then check whether or not they have duplicate characters in them, right? So this would be really easy. We could create a function that was like, you know, has dupe, and it would take in a string s. And then all it's gonna do is we could just like, you know, there are a bunch of ways that we could do this, but probably the easiest would be to create some sort of set char and, equals new set. And then all we would do is we would go through the string and we'd say, you know, for character C in the string, add it to the set, or like check whether the set contains. So if set contains S, then we, you know, return false. And otherwise, because that means that we've already seen the character before, right? And then otherwise, we add it to the set. We add it to the set and continue. And then if we get to the end and we haven't found any duplicates, we can return true. It won't let me write. Slow down. Okay. We can return true. And so that's going to be our, you know, our function for finding the duplicates. So that's pretty simple. And then all we have to do, the only other thing we have to do, is just iterate over the entire string and find all the substrings. And we could even optimize that further by saying, you know, we're only going to find the substrings that have a length of 26 or less, right? Because remember how we talked about how the length is limited to 26. And so that's a brute force solution. We should probably make sure that we're clear on what the time complexity is going to be of that. And so with our brute force solution, our time complexity, the number of different substrings that we're going to have is going to be n squared, right? Because we're going to have, you know, for I equals 0 to n, and then we're going to have for j equals I plus 1 to n. These are all of our substrings, right? We're going to have basically our string, and we're going to have two pointers, and we're going to increment the different pointers, and that's going to give us each of our substrings. So we're going to have O of n substrings, and each of the longest of those substrings, or sorry, O of n squared substrings, and then the longest of those substrings is going to be O of n, right? The longest substring is the whole thing, which is length n. And so, and then our determining whether it includes any duplicates is also going to take O of n, is going to take O of n time based on the length of the input string. And so since we have all of these internal strings are going to be length O of n, we get O of n squared times O of n, which is going to give us O of n cubed, right? Because it's just n squared times n. And then in terms of the space complexity, we're using the space to store all of these strings. All of these substrings, we need to either store them or we can run our function. So let's assume that we're being a little bit more efficient and we're just checking each time we generate a substring, we're checking whether it contains duplicates. But our duplicates function still takes O of n space because it's filling in the entire set, right? We are storing each of the characters in a set. And so we get a space complexity also of O of n. So, you know, time and space. And so from here, now that we have this brute force solution that works, we're gonna look at like, how do we optimize from this, right? Like what is the, where can we go from here and can we make any improvements from here? And the answer is yes, we probably can because we don't actually necessarily need to generate all of the different substrings. Right? Because we only need to generate the substrings that are potentially the longest substring. And maybe we can actually improve on our approach by, you know, looking at different ways of approaching the inputs. And maybe we don't need to generate all the substrings, or maybe we only generate sort of the maximal substrings. So like one even like basic, more efficient way we could do is we could start with all the substrings of length 26, then all the substrings of length 25, then all the substrings of length 24. And what we would do if we did that is, worst case, it's still going to be the same, but it's essentially like doing a breadth first search and trying to, when you're trying to find the shortest path between A and B, because what we're going to do is the first time that we find a valid substring, we know that it's the longest one because we started with the longest and went down. But if we've studied strings a bit, hopefully you're realizing that there is another approach that we can take here. And the other approach that we can take would be to use some sort of sliding window. And so I want to talk about like how we're going to do this and just sort of talk through the approach here. So the idea of a sliding window is that we're going to have two pointers, and we're going to basically keep track of, and essentially every time we go through the pointers, we're moving the pointers, we're trying to keep expanding our window to encompass the biggest valid solution that we can. And so what is that going to look like here? I'm just going to go through an example because I think it's going to make a lot more sense when we look at this rather than if I try and just describe in vague generalities. So let's look at this example here. I'll rewrite it bigger. We have A, B, C, A, B, C, B, B. And so with our sliding window, we're going to start with two pointers. We're going to start with an I pointer and a J pointer. And so at the beginning, they'll both be pointing here. So we have I and we have J. And then we also need to know at any given point we're basically going to keep track of what are the characters in our current substring that we're tracking with I and J. And so we're going to keep some sort of set. You could also use just a Boolean array of length 26, which is actually kind of a nice way to do it because then technically you're using like linear extra or constant extra space because it's a fixed size no matter what. So that's something that we can do. But just for simplicity, I'm going to write this as a set. And so our set is going to be empty to begin with. And then now we're going to start with I and J are both pointing to A. And so that means that our substring, so I'll write this here too, is going to be this string A. And so since it's A, we're going to add the A to our set because A is one of the characters that is included in our string. And now we're going to increment J. So we increment this J pointer to here. And now what we're going to look is is the current element that J is pointing to already in our set? Basically, is this string from I to J still valid based on our parameter that we can only have, that we can't have overlapping or that we can't have the same character more than once? And in this case, it's not because we only have A in our set. And so we're going to add B to the set like this, and then we're going to update our substring. So now our substring is AB. And we don't really need to keep this as a separate string, but I'm just doing it to show you how, like what we're actually doing here. And so now we have this substring AB and nothing has happened yet. So we're going to extend further. And you can see like what we're basically doing is we're expanding our substring. We're expanding our window as far as we can without invalidating our, invariant, which is that the substring can't contain the same character more than once. And so when we get to here, we're gonna have now A, B, C. We're gonna add the C to the set. The C didn't cause any problems, so we're gonna add C to our substring. And now we are going to say, okay, that's good. So now our longest string is length 3, right? So we're probably just keeping track of like what is the longest substring that we found that was valid as we're going. We don't need to keep track of the actual string, right? And so now we're going to increment our I again, and this is where our J again, and this is where it gets interesting because we're going to increment J up to here. And now is where we start running into a problem. And this is where the sliding window is so cool. So now we're going to see, okay, crap. A is actually already in our array. It is already in our set. And so this string is not valid because we have broken our invariant. And so what we're going to do is now we're going to increment I and move I forward until it is valid once again. Right? And so what we do, and this is actually a reason why it's a little bit better to have an array. It would probably be better for us to have an array here than a set. So we're going to have like our letters, and then what we'll do is we'll have an array of integers, and so it's going to start as 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, etc. And then as we see them, we're going to increment them by 1. So right now our array should look like 2, 1, 1, 0, etc. Right, because we have 2 A's, we have 1 B, and we have 1 C. And so what that means is that now, each time we're checking, we're just checking to make sure that none of these are greater than 1, essentially. And so we're going to check whether, we're going to check this, we're going to see that this is 2, so it's invalid. And now we're going to increment I. And so each time we increment I, we're cutting off the beginning of the string, and so we're decrementing that previous character. And so when we move to B, we have our I's here now, and now we remove this A from our substring, so we're going to decrement it in our array. And so now we have 1 again, and so now we know that this string is also valid. So our new substring is BCA, which is also of length 3, so this would also be a valid substring. Now that we have a valid string, we increment again, so we're going to increment our J up to here. We increment this to 2, and now you see we have a problem again, right? And so we're going to increment I by 1. And I is going to move to here. And now, again, since we removed a B, this goes back to 1, making our substring valid once again. So C, A, B. Now, this is going to repeat, you know, I is going to, or J is going to move to here. And so, again, it's invalid, so I moves to here. And now I want to show you, I just wanted to show you this one last example because this, in this case, it behaves a little bit differently. So now what we have is we have 1, 1, 1. This is a valid string, A, B, C. And then we're going to increment J by 1. And so now we have 2 B's, right? We have 2 here. And then we're going to increment A by 1, or I by 1, sorry, to here. And so this becomes 0. But notice that it's still not valid, right? So in this case, our result is still invalid, and so we actually have to increment I again. And so anytime it's invalid, we keep incrementing I until it becomes valid once again. So we get here, and then, you know, you could do the rest. You can see how the rest is going to play out. There are no bigger substrings. And so this is how we use the, like, sliding window strategy to actually approach this problem and do it in a much more efficient time. And so when we think about the time complexity here, we're actually iterating just I and J to the end of our array once. So we're really just, this part is actually just O of N. And then the only other part that's taking a little bit of time is, unfortunately, if we do this with this array approach, you have to realize that we're gonna have to iterate over the array every time to check. So if we do the set, or if we could do this with a, the more efficient way to do this really than doing an array would be to do a hash map. Because when you do a hash map, you're gonna have, like, basically, you know, a map of your letters mapped to the count, right? So you'd have like A, 0, B, 2, and C, 1. But the problem is that whenever you have one that's greater than 0, or that's greater than 1, you're still gonna have to iterate through. So you might be able to optimize this, but it's gonna get a little bit trickier to do that. And so, you know, let's say if we were to approach it in this case, we're gonna have a O of N complexity for each time we go through. And so that's gonna give us a total complexity if we combine these two of O of N squared, which is better than the cubic time that we had before. And so this is basically how we approach this problem. Hope this all makes sense, and good luck with the rest of your homework this week. Thanks so much for sticking with me through this video. If you enjoyed this and are looking for more, you can check out our free 50 interview questions guide, where we go through 50 of the most common coding interview questions. And if you like this video, make sure that you hit that subscribe button and the like button. Let us know what you thought, and check out some of our other videos. We have a ton of other content like this, and I look forward to seeing you in the next video.